Today we're going to talk about the history of segregation and racist policy in Rochester. First, let's talk about the difference between individual racism and structural. Individual racism is when you have personal prejudice, bias, or you're treating someone differently because of the color of their skin. Structural racism is when laws, policies, and practices negatively hurt communities of color. Today we're going to learn about segregation and structural racism in Rochester through the real estate industry, restrictive covenants, and redlining. This is Howard Coles, the editor of the Frederick Douglass Voice Black newspaper in Rochester, New York. He did a study on the ways that people of color were mistreated when they moved to Rochester in the 1930s and 40s. In his report, he stated that there are numerous apartments and houses which people of color can't rent because certain big real estate agencies set the example of refusing to rent to black people. A real estate agent is someone whose job it is to help people find and buy a house. After Howard Cole's survey, the city of Rochester did an even bigger study. They found that over half the structures in the two neighborhoods that black people were allowed to live were not safe for them to live in because of how poorly built the houses were by the white landlords. The men who sold homes to people had to follow rules in order to keep their jobs. One rule they had to follow was to make sure they never sold homes to black people in white neighborhoods. They had to do this whether they personally were prejudiced against black people or not. Frank Drum, in the picture, was in charge of this racist rule in Rochester. All across the city of Rochester and suburbs like Brighton, Pittsford, and Penfield, there were special rules written into legal documents that proved a person owned their land. One of these rules was called a restrictive covenant. A restrictive covenant was a rule that said no people of color were legally allowed to buy or live in the house above the land. In Brighton, 371 homes in the Meadowbrook neighborhood all said this: no lot or dwelling shall be sold to or occupied by a colored person. This is a picture of the actual restrictive covenant that's on the land for all the Meadowbrook homes. Kodak built these homes for their employees and wanted to make sure no black people were allowed to live there. This was perfectly legal till 1968. Builders like Fred Hills and Frank Drum of Alliance Realty Corporation were encouraged by the federal government not to allow black people to buy land in the homes they built. This happened all across our city and the country. Here's a picture of the restrictive covenant they wrote for the houses surrounding Irondequoit High School. It reads, "Dwelling shall be occupied by persons of the Caucasian race only." Here are a few other locations of neighborhoods with restrictive covenants under the land for all of the homes, saying that black people can't live there. And these are only a few of the ones that I've found. There are several thousand more across our city. Between 1910 and 1970, millions of African Americans moved from the South to northern cities like Rochester. Many people of color in Rochester came from Sanford, Florida. They were hired to pick fruit in Webster, Wayne County, Brockport, and Hilton. Most families of color lived in cramped apartments in Rochester and were not allowed to own homes in Rochester. In 1934, President Roosevelt, who you can see above, helped pass a law that would help white people buy houses all across the United States. In this law, the law said that blacks and whites should be segregated, and it told builders and real estate agents to put restrictive covenants like the ones in Irondequoit Meadowbrook and the land they built on. In order to keep white and black people separated, the government had maps made of almost every city in the U.S. Here's Rochester's map, made by the Homeowners Loan Corporation, also called HOLC. You can see a bunch more maps in New York State like ours if you go to the website. 1937, the government created the Homeowners Loan Corporation, which surveyed and rated neighborhoods in several northern cities, including Rochester. Areas shaded red and yellow, or redlined areas, indicated the government was less likely to back mortgages because those areas were potentially dangerous, polluted, or had residents of color living there already. Here's what one of the survey forms a real estate agent used in the Cornhill neighborhood of Rochester. It was their job to count how many Negroes lived in each neighborhood, so they would know which areas to shade in red to make sure white and black people wouldn't live near each other. The FHA only backed mortgages, Federal Housing Administration, part of the federal government, only backed mortgages, loans for white people, in blue and green parts of the city, and for white people buying and building houses in the suburbs. This meant that white people get money from the banks to live in the suburbs, but black people couldn't get money from the bank to help them do this. During this time, the FHA and VA insured half of all new mortgages nationwide. This means that over half of all people in the U.S. that bought a house during this 30 to 40 year period were able to buy their house mainly and only because the government helped them do it. The FHA and VA gave out over $120 billion in mortgage insurance to help white people buy homes from 1934 to 1968. Over 35 million families benefited from these FHA-backed loans. 98% of these people were white. People of color like Howard Coles and Dr. Cooper fought back against these racist laws. They helped New York State's governor to do a big report on how bad things were for them in Rochester and other cities. The report was called Negroes in Five New York Cities. The report said that 80% of people of color in Monroe County lived in the 3rd and 7th wards. Housing was very crowded. The report also said that more than 1,600 units in both wards where black people were forced to live either had no bathroom or a shared bathroom, and in more than 2,000 units, there was more than one person living in each room. These ghettos contained 20% of all units with no private bathrooms, and 30% of the units had no running water. The report said that no person of color in Monroe County was given an FHA or VA loan for a mortgage in any new suburban development, including Henrietta. It also said that in 1950, only 57 families of color owned a home in a predominantly white neighborhood, and the way they could do that was only through a private deal, something tricky, or a personal or friendship with a realtor who was white. 11 people of color lived in Henrietta by 1960, including Mr. and Mrs. Bias, who you see here, and Dr. Walter Cooper. They worked with anti-racist white people at the NAACP to secretly buy their houses in Henrietta. The Bias family moved to Henrietta because when they tried to go to a rondaquoit, white people kept throwing bricks through their windows to scare them away from living in their all-white neighborhoods. 16 families of color that lived in the suburbs reported in the report that they faced abuse, ostracism, and destruction of property. During this time, the Ku Klux Klan, a white Protestant terrorist organization that tries to keep white and black people separate, was in Rochester. They had a meeting of 8,000 Klan members in East Rochester in the 1920s. James and Alice Young in the 1950s tried to buy a house in a white neighborhood in the city. They received threats from the KKK of Milbank Street saying that they were going to burn their house down if they didn't move. Up until 1981, white people burned crosses in people of color's front yards, right here in Henrietta on East River Road. By 1960s, things were getting pretty bad for people of color. They were upset, so upset that many started to protest, to march, and some even rioted. Rochester had a 3-day riot in 1964 because of the bad housing conditions, the segregation, and the problems with the police dogs biting them. The president did a big report on what the problem was. The report said, "Our nation is moving towards two societies, one black, one white, separate and unequal." And it said that something had to be done to stop segregation in housing and to help black people buy homes, or else more riots were going to happen. But white people didn't want to pass a civil rights law that allowed white and black people to live in desegregated neighborhoods. After Martin Luther King was killed, more riots happened, and the president and his fellow lawmakers realized they had to do something. They made a law called the 1968 Fair Housing Act. Sadly, this law has been only enforced a few times. It's not a strong law. It says that if you're a person of color who's unable to buy a house, you have to find a lawyer, spend a lot of money, and prove before a judge that you were discriminated against when you tried to buy a house. President Nixon even told the people working for him never to enforce this law. Ed Doherty works for the Rochester Area Community Foundation. He's an expert in housing and the causes of poverty in Rochester, and he says that the strong attitudes and policies that encourage racial and ethnic segregation had and still have a profound impact on our community. You can see our map on this map that we looked at earlier, how segregated Rochester is. And when you overlay it with the map that Holick made from the federal government to keep neighborhoods segregated, you can see that in those redlined areas, it's still where the majority of people of color still live in Rochester today, even though the laws have changed. 92% of the people who live in redlined neighborhoods are people of color today. You can see that where the neighborhoods were previously redlined, there's also the fewest number of people who own a home. And It's where the poorest people in our whole county live. Wealth is how much money a person or family is worth. The median white family in 2011 was worth $111,000, while black families were only worth $7,000. It's a big problem that scientists call a wealth gap. Another way to think about the wealth gap is for every $100 that an average white family has in wealth or in the bank, an average black family has only $5. Redlining and segregation have led to where we are, having the highest rates of child poverty, African Americans making less than half the amount of money that white people do, and African Americans and Latino people being less than half as likely to own their own homes as their white counterparts. Hopefully you've learned a little about segregation and structural racism in Rochester through the real estate industry, restrictive covenants, and redlining.